Robert's sister confirmed that Alison rejected Robert's proposal of marriage, but Robert did not discuss the romance widely. We cannot and should not know all his secrets. Meanwhile, whilst Robert was still romancing, his father was in dispute with his landlord, David McClure. The case went on for 3 years before Lord Braxfield, of whom we shall hear more, finally found for Robert's father, but he was ruined and died on the 13th of February 1784. By this time, Robert had altered the family name to Burns without the E, the common Ayrshire spelling. Robert was left to fend for his mother and the family. I was happy to be able to rent them the farm at Mosgiel, near Mochlin. In the summer of the same year, Robert met Jean Armour, 17 years old, one of the six young belles of Mochlin. In Mochlin there dwells six proper young belles, the pride of the place and its neighbourhood, ah. Their carriage and dress a stranger would guess, in London or Paris they'd gotten it, ah. Miss Miller is fine, Miss Merklin's divine, Miss Smith she has wit, and Miss Betty is braw, splendid. There's beauty and fortune to go with Miss Morton, but Armour's the jewel for me of them all. Robert wasted little time. By March 1786, his jewel was pregnant and had a paper from Robert which could be interpreted as a marriage contract. Her father knew of Burns's reputation and with good reason considered him irresponsible. Why, only the previous year, Robert had seduced Elizabeth Betty Patton, his mother's servant girl, who gave birth to an illegitimate daughter now being looked after by his mother. Mr. Armour immediately dispatched daughter Jean to Paisley to stay with a relative and took the marriage contract to a fellow lawyer, Robert Aitken, to nullify it. There would have been much correspondence on the issue, but I discovered from Aitken's daughter that many of the items had strangely disappeared. It is not difficult to see why others would be interested in Robert. It was 40 years since the young pretender Bonnie Prince Charlie had landed in the Hebrides only to be defeated at Culloden. But there was still strong opposition to rule from London and to the oppression by the landed gentry. Robert openly sympathised with these views and for the advance of the new light in religious matters which were still entrenched in bigotry and hypocrisy. He made no secret either for his support of the principles soon to be enshrined in the French Revolution. Two of Aitken's clerks were local. The third, Pascal, had been innocently recommended to Aitken by James Cunningham, the Earl of Glencairn, following a request from Lord Braxfield's office. It would be 6 years before the English Secret Service would be centralised through the Alien Office to check on the influx of French nobility fleeing the Revolution, but in Scotland the spy network was active well before then. Lord Braxfield, already familiar with the Burns family, would subsequently impact on all radicals by sentencing Thomas Muir, a free-thinking Edinburgh advocate, to 14 years transportation for alleged sedition. Pascal did not consider himself dishonest. Spies never do. His brief was to listen out for a potential treasonable activity, supposedly centred on Masonic lodges, and was under instruction to tarnish Burns's reputation. I believe Pascal passed the papers on Jean Armour to William Fisher, an archetypal hypocritical Calvinist of the old school. The Kirk session on the 10th of June duly records Jean's claim against Robert as father of her unborn child. In Robert's eyes, Jean had deserted him and had been treacherous in giving the marriage contract to Aitken. On the first count, he applied to the Kirk Sessions for a certificate to say he was single. He received this on the 25th of June, but not before he was publicly humiliated by Fisher, Hooly Willy, as Burns called him. The Kirk fined him and sentenced him to wear sackcloth and to sit on the creepy chair, a three-legged penance stool, on three Sabbaths. Aitken mentioned that Pascal had been disgusted that the man of the cloth would stoop so low. I believe other cases increasingly troubled Pascal, particularly where tenant farmers toiling under the harshest of conditions were so easily dispossessed of their land. Meanwhile, Robert turned to another conquest, a nursemaid in my own home, Mary Campbell, Highland Mary. In his own words, she was a charming lass who ever blessed a man with generous love. I am convinced Robert was spiritually and physically deeply attracted to Mary, and he proposed to her. She accepted, and on the 14th of May 1786 they were married in their own eyes and by local style by exchanging Bibles, planning then to emigrate to far-off lands for a new start in life. Mary, a joyous, youthful lass, set sail for the West Highlands to make final arrangements with her family before adventuring to far-off lands.